Simon & Schuster Audio presents More Twisted by Jeffery Deaver. Read by Boyd Gaines, Skipp Sudduth, and Frederick Weller.
Chapter and verse. Reverend, can I call you Reverend? The round, middle-aged man in the clerical collar smiled. That works for me. I'm Detective Mike Silverman with the County Sheriff's Department. Reverend Stanley Lansing nodded and examined the ID and badge that the nervously slim, salt-and-pepper-haired detective offered.
Is something wrong?
Nothing involving you, sir. Not directly, I mean. Just hoping you might be able to help us with the situation we have.
Situation? Well, come on inside, please, officer.
The men walked into the office connected to the First Presbyterian Church of Bedford, a quaint, white house of worship that Silverman had passed 1,000 times on his route between office and home and never really thought about. That is, not until the murder this morning. Reverend Lansing's office was musty, and a gauze of dust covered most of the furniture. He seemed embarrassed.
Have to apologize. My wife and I have been away on vacation for the past week. She's still up at the lake. I came back to write my sermon, and to deliver it to my flock this Sunday, of course.
He gave a wry laugh.
If there's anybody in the pews. Funny how religious commitment seems to go up around Christmas and then dip around vacation time.
Then the man of the cloth looked around the office with a frown.
I'm afraid I don't have anything to offer you. The church secretary's off, too. Although, between you and me, you're better off not sampling her coffee.
No, I'm fine, Silverman said.
So what can I do for you, officer?
I won't keep you long. I need some religious expertise on a case we're running. I would have gone to my father's rabbi, but my question's got to do with the New Testament. That's your bailiwick, right? More than ours.
Well, the friendly, gray-haired reverend said, wiping his glasses on his jacket lapel and replacing them. I'm just a small-town pastor, hardly an expert, but I probably know Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John better than your average rabbi, I suspect. Now, tell me how I can help.
You've heard about the Witness Protection Program, right?
Like Goodfellas, that sort of thing? The Sopranos?
More or less, yep. The U.S. Marshals run the federal program, but we have our own state witness protection system.
Really? I didn't know that. But I guess it makes sense.
I'm in charge of the program in the county here, and one of the people we're protecting is about to appear as a witness in a trial in Hamilton. It's our job to keep him safe through the trial, and after we get a conviction, we hope, then we'll get him a new identity and move him out of the state.
A mafia trial?
Something like that.
Silverman couldn't go into the exact details of the case, how the witness, Randall Pease, a minder for drug dealer Tommy Doyle, had seen his boss put a bullet into the brain of a rival. Despite Doyle's reputation for ruthlessly murdering anyone who was a threat to him, Pease agreed to testify for a reduced sentence on assault, drug, and gun charges. The state prosecutor shipped Pease off to Silverman's jurisdiction, 100 miles from Hamilton, to keep him safe. Rumor was that Doyle would do anything, pay any money, to kill his former underling, since Pease's testimony could get him the death penalty or put him away for life. Silverman had stashed the witness in a safe house near the sheriff's department and put a round-the-clock guard on him. The detective gave the reverend a generic description of what had happened, not mentioning names, and then said, "But there's been a setback. We had a CI, a confidential informant." That's a snitch, right? Silverman laughed. I learned that from Law and Order. I watch it every chance I get. CSI, too. I love cop shows.
He frowned.
You mind if I say cop?
Works for me. Anyway, the informant got solid information that a professional killer's been hired to murder our witness before the trial next week.
A hitman?
Yep.
Oh, my. The Reverend frowned as he touched his neck and rubbed it near the stiff white clerical collar where it seemed to chafe. But the bad guys made the snitch, found out about him, I mean, and had him killed before he could give us the details about who the hitman is and how he planned to kill my witness.
Oh, I'm so sorry, the Reverend said sympathetically. I'll say a prayer for the man.
Silverman grunted anemic thanks, but his true thoughts were that the scurvy little snitch deserved an express lane ride to hell, not only for being a loser punk addict, but for dying before he could give the detective the particulars about the potential hit on Pease. Detective Mike Silverman didn't share with the minister that he himself had been in trouble lately in the sheriff's department and had been shipped off to Siberia, witness protection, because he hadn't closed any major cases in a while. He needed to make sure this assignment went smoothly, and he absolutely could not let Pease get killed. The detective continued, "Here's where you come in, I hope. When the informant was stabbed, he didn't die right away. He managed to write a note about a Bible passage. We think it was a clue as to how the hitman was going to kill our witness. But it's like a puzzle. We can't figure it out." The Reverend seemed intrigued.
"Something from the New Testament, you said?"
"Yep," Silverman said. He opened his notebook. The note said, "He's on his way. Look out." Then he wrote a chapter and verse from the Bible. We think he was going to write something else, but he didn't get a chance. He was Catholic, so we figure he knew the Bible pretty well, and knew something in particular in that passage that'd tell us how the hitman's going to come after our witness. The Reverend turned around and looked for a Bible on his shelf. Finally, he located one and flipped it open.
"What verse?"
"Luke 12:15." The minister found the passage and read, "Then to the people he said, 'Beware. Be on your guard against greed of every kind, for even when someone has more than enough, his possessions do not give him life.'" My partner brought a Bible from home. He's Christian, but he's not real religious, not a Bible thumper. Oh, hey, no offense.
"None taken. We're Presbyterians. We don't thump."
Silverman smiled. He didn't have any idea of what that might mean. "I got to thinking about your church. It's the closest one to the station house, so I thought I'd stop by and see if you can help us out. Is there anything in there you can see that'd suggest how the defendant might try to kill our witness?" The Reverend read some more from the tissue-thin pages.
"This section is in one of the Gospels, where different disciples tell the story of Jesus. In chapter 12 of Luke, Jesus is warning the people about the Pharisees, urging them not to live a sinful life."
"Who were they exactly, the Pharisees?"
"They were a religious sect. In essence, they believed that God existed to serve them, not the other way around. They felt they were better than everyone else and put people down. Well, that was the story back then. You never know, of course, if it's accurate. People did just as much political spinning then as they do now."
Reverend Lansing tried to turn on the desk lamp, but it didn't work. He fiddled with the curtains, finally opening them and letting more light into the murky office. He read the passage several times more, squinting in concentration, nodding. Silverman looked around the dim place. Books, mostly. It seemed more like a professor's study than a church office. No pictures or anything else personal. You'd think even a minister would have pictures of family on his desk or walls. Finally, the man looked up.
"So far, nothing really jumps out at me."
He seemed frustrated. Silverman felt the same way. Ever since the CI had been found stabbed to death that morning, the detective had been wrestling with the words from the Gospel according to Luke, trying to decipher the meaning.
"Beware."
Reverend Lansing continued.
"But I have to say, I'm fascinated with the idea. It's just like the Da Vinci Code. You read it?"
"No."
"It was great fun. All about secret codes and hidden messages. Say, if it's okay with you, Detective, I'd like to spend some time researching, doing some thinking about this. I love puzzles."
"I'd appreciate it, Reverend."
"I'll do what I can. You have that man under pretty good guard, I assume."
"Oh, you bet. But it'll be risky getting him to court.
We gotta figure out how the hitman's going to come at him. And the sooner the better, I assume.
Yes, sir.
I'll get right to it.
Grateful for the man's willingness to help, but discouraged he had no quick answers, Silverman walked out through the silent, deserted church. He climbed into his car and drove to the safe house, checked on Randall Pease. The witness was his typical obnoxious self, complaining constantly, but the officer babysitting him reported that there'd been no sign of any threats around the safe house. The detective then returned.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.